Let us pray. God of light, let your Holy Spirit come into our darkness and open our hearts, that your word may show us the blessings you intend for all creation. Amen. Our first scripture reading this morning, and our second one as well, is from a publication entitled The Message, which is a paraphrase of the Bible written by the Reverend Eugene Peterson, a Presbyterian minister who passed away earlier this week, joining the Church Eternal and Triumphant. I bless God every chance I get. My lungs expand with his praise. I live and breathe God. If things weren't going well, hear this and be happy. Join me in spreading the news. Together, let's get the word out. God met me more than halfway. He freed me from my anxious fears. Look at him. Give him your warmest smile. Never hide your feelings from him. When I was desperate, I called out, and God got me out of a tight spot. God's angel sets up a circle of protection around us while we pray. Open your mouth and taste. Open your eyes and see how good God truly is. Blessed are you who run to him. Disciples so often get into trouble still. God is there every time. He is your bodyguard, shielding every bone. Not a finger gets broken. The wicked commit slow suicide. They waste their lives hating good. God pays for each slave's freedom. No one who runs to him loses out. This ends the first reading.
Our second reading comes from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 10, verses 46 through 52. They spent some time in Jericho. As Jesus was leaving town, trailed by his disciples and a parade of people, a blind beggar by the name of Bartimaeus, son of Timaeus, was sitting alongside the road. When he heard that Jesus the Nazarene was passing by, he began to cry out, "Son of David, Jesus, mercy, have mercy on me." Many tried to hush him up, but he yelled all the louder, "Son of David, mercy, have mercy on me." Jesus stopped in his tracks. "Call him over." They called him. "It's your lucky day. Get up. He's calling you to come." Throwing off his coat, he was on his feet at once and came to Jesus. Jesus said, "What can I do for you?" The blind man said, "Rabbi, I want to see." "On your way," said Jesus. "Your faith has saved and healed you." In that very instant, he recovered his sight and followed Jesus down the road. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Well, this is an amazing story. It's amazing because there are many stories of Jesus healing people and casting out demons all throughout the Gospel of Mark. Deaf people, people with fever, people with demons, people with withered hands, a bleeding woman, and a seemingly dead little girl, to name just a few. And out of all these people, only Bartimaeus is mentioned by name. Now, those of you who went to Sunday school today and talked about this passage in your class, did your teacher point that out? Yes, okay, A plus, choir class, A plus, they're on the ball. Oh, even better, okay, so one of the teachers did not, but an alert reader pointed that out. Very good, very good. And really, we have no idea why. And it's also an amazing story because this is a short story, just a handful of verses, and yet it is full of takeaways. You know, at Silver Wings Supper this week, we played a little game called How Many Words Can You Make Out of the Word Presbyterian? And as it turns out, you can make quite a few. I believe the winning table actually found about 150 different words. And a fun way to read Bible stories is to read it and ask, well, how many things can I get out of this passage? And in this little story, there are a bunch, but we're just going to look at six. You've heard of three-point sermons. This is a six-pointer. We'll still get you out in time to make it to Annie's and McFarland's before the lunch rush. Now, remember, Jesus has begun his journey to Jerusalem, the place where he is going to suffer and die, and after 3 days be raised again, and he's told this to his disciples over and over. And they come to the city of Jericho, which is on their way, and it's about 10 miles east of Jerusalem, out in the wilderness. And Jesus has picked up a sizable crowd. It's not just Jesus and 12 guys, it's a whole caravan. Bartimaeus hears who's passing by and begins to yell, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me, on me, me." Persistently and unapologetically demanding Jesus' attention, hollering for help, not for his sick mom, not for his ailing daughter, not for his demon-possessed son, but for himself. You know, the only other people in this gospel bold enough to seek help from Jesus for themselves are the leper who's very meek. He kneels at Jesus' feet and says, "Lord, if you choose, if it's not too much trouble, if it's not a bother, could you heal me?" And the other one is the woman, the hemorrhaging woman, who dares not touch Jesus directly, but satisfies herself with touching the hem of his garment. Well, Bartimaeus can't see well enough to do either one of those things. So he hears the Jesus crowd is coming, and he belts it out, "For all he is worth, not for anyone else, just for himself." And takeaway number one today is, because some of you need to hear this, it is okay to ask for help and for healing for yourself. Some of us still need to hear that. I've actually met people who are uncomfortable to ask for prayer or to pray for themselves. They can do it if it's for someone else. And Bartimaeus shows once and for all, it's okay to advocate for yourself. It's okay to be loud and assertive and get in God's face for yourself. Your life and your wellness matter to God. Which leads us to takeaway number two. Jesus hears him and Jesus stops with 10 miles to go and a crowd surging around him. Jesus slams on the brakes and makes everybody else wait. Just imagine if the Macy's Thanksgiving Day Parade had to stop because a kid is riding his little tricycle, his little big wheel, down there in the middle of 34th Street. Or picture an entire presidential motorcade grinding to a halt because a turtle is crossing the road. Last Saturday morning, we partnered with a group called Forge, an organization of young professionals in their 20s and 30s here in Topeka. We partnered with them to host an event called Inspiring a Healthy Community. And the event included breakfast and some workshops on health-related topics and giveaway bags with food and hygiene kits. And we did not know how many people would come. We knew to be ready for anywhere from 0 to 250. And, you know, we kind of hoped for the 250, if we were going to be honest. But it was up to the community health agencies to get the word out, not us. And over the course of several hours, maybe about 40 people from the community came. And rather than wishing more people had come, we can look at it the way Jesus would. Wow, 40 people came here seeking help, and they received it. And even one person coming would have been worth it. The one person whose stomach stops growling because we made sure the blessing box was stocked is worth it. The one kid who shows up for Sunday school, the one visitor who draws closer to God because of our worship, it is all worth it. And so takeaway number two is the reminder for those of us seeking to do great things and have a big impact that Jesus stopped for one person. And if we feel like maybe life is passing us by as we are at home caring for an elderly spouse or parents, or reading Goodnight Moon for the 413th time to a toddler, Jesus stopped everything for one person. Takeaway number three is a little more subtle. One of the things that draws us into this short little story is the fact that as Bartimaeus is crying out to Jesus from the side of the road, the people around him don't seem to want to hear it. And it's not clear why. Maybe the people don't want Jesus to stop because they're on a roll, they're making good time. And they're all sharing in this feeling of momentum, kind of like you hate to stop when you're on a road trip, you're making good time, and somebody's got to go potty. Ugh. Or maybe Bartimaeus sounds annoying, like the whiny kid on the 9-hour airplane flight. And maybe the shushers think they're being helpful to Jesus. Maybe Bartimaeus and his blindness are just something people don't want to think about, like when you're in the middle of a great TV show or football game and all of a sudden a commercial with starving children pops up. You know you should care, but you just don't want to think about that right now. Whatever's going on, Jesus does not get mad at the crowd. He doesn't shame them or scold them for trying to silence this man. He just stops, has them call Bartimaeus, and this transforms the crowd. They stop shushing and they start encouraging. Cheer up, Bart! He's calling you. And because Bartimaeus is blind, surely they helped escort him and get to Jesus. Have you seen that documentary about Mr. Rogers called Won't You Be My Neighbor? Has anybody seen that? Well, Mr. Rogers was not one to shame people either, especially not children. And one particularly hot issue during the early years of his TV show was integration. The documentary showed some old news footage of a white motel owner pouring acid into his whites-only motel swimming pool to force the African Americans who were in it to get out. And so one day on his show in 1969, Mr. Rogers filled up a little wading pool, put it in the backyard on his set, and he sat there soaking his bare feet in it. Officer Clemens, an African American character on the show, comes along and Mr. Rogers says, "I'm just soaking my feet in this pool because my feet are tired. Won't you join me?" And he does. And that's all. No shaming or scolding those bigoted white people, just this image of the white man and his black friend side by side with their feet in the same wading pool. We are called to speak out, but takeaway number three, and we know this, it's what we do that people remember. And we're learning that shaming and scolding just doesn't work. They're never as effective as a courageous act of grace. Takeaway number four is the gentle reminder that it is in the interruptions that life seems to happen. Jesus isn't on his preaching and healing tour anymore. He's headed to the city where he knows he will die. And I think if I were Jesus, I'd be stressed. I'd be very wrapped up in my own fears and my own problems. Talk about having a lot on your mind. Yet Jesus allows himself to be interrupted, even at this point where he must realize he can't get to everybody. And this healing story that almost didn't happen is the one story where the person who is healed is remembered today by name. What are our interruptions? Along those lines is takeaway number five, who is calling for our help right now? What person or what issue just won't leave us?